So, hello everyone, and welcome to today's webinar on Can You Trust Your Compiler? This webinar is jointly hosted by Absint and Vector Informatik. Our guest speaker today is Daniel Kästner, CTO at Absint. I am supported by my colleague Ingo Niklas, Field Application Engineer at Vector Informatik. And my name is Winfried Schröder. I am Business Development Manager for the Vectorcast product family and responsible for today's moderation. Let's have a look at today's agenda. We are starting with a very quick introduction to our solution for software testing. Then Daniel will tell us more about Trustable Embedded Compiler. In the following part, Ingo will show us how Vectorcast supports embedded compiler in various industries. And in the Q&A session, we will answer your questions regarding the presentation. Please use the WebEx Q&A window at your desk and address your questions to all panelists at any time during this webinar. So about dynamic software test automation. The Vectorcast testing platform is a family of products that automates activities for dynamic software testing across the software development lifecycle. Supports the creation and the management of test cases to prove that the low-level software requirements have been tested. If we have a look at the V model, we can see Vectorcast provides testing solutions for all phases of testing, from low-level software testing to full system testing. Testing can be performed natively on a PC or on a target hardware at all levels. Testing matrix ties the various pieces together across the lifecycle. Vectorcast is part of the Vector tool chain and has interfaces and integrations to other Vector tools such as Score, Canoe, VTest Studio, VTest Systems, or Virtual Target. In addition, it has integrations to many other products from third-party vendors that you may already use in your development environment. This includes solutions for application lifecycle management, requirements management software, code analyzers, modeling tools, and so on. Oops. Sorry. Yes, if you have a look in the history of the Vectorcast product family, we can see the first version of Vectorcast was already launched in 1992, shown here in red. That means that we are facing a very mature product. It was initially developed to automatically determine code coverage for safety critical embedded software in the aerospace industry. But in the following years, it was extended by a unit test tool, and it got numerous extensions and improvements, of course. The first version of Vectorcast supported Ada, but today Vectorcast also supports C and C++ up to version 17. As already said, Vectorcast started in the development departments for safety critical applications in the avionics industry. Because of standards and obligations of functional safety, which have found their way into all industries today, Vectorcast is widely used in many other industries like automotive, medical, railway, and others. Test automation today does not only mean to build test driver and tests automatically. Due to the fast-growing code bases, the lack of qualified developers, and the increasing time pressure due to faster release cycles, testing activities have to be carried out as early as possible in the development process and have to be automated as much as possible. Vectorcast product family supports continuous testing, continuous integration, and DevOps through numerous features and as parallel features such as parallel execution, change-based testing, support for almost every embedded compiler on the market, integrations to other third-party tools, and the ability to execute all functions using scripts. The possibility to run embedded software tests on the host, the simulator, or the real target hardware in parallel and for different branches shortens development time massively and sustainably. In the field, we see testing process varies from organization to organization. Independent of whether the products are used in safety critical areas or not, everybody knows that only well-tested products are of good quality and successful. It's therefore important to know what the testing process currently looks like and how it could be improved. VectorCast reduces the time needed for testing through tool-supported test creation and wide-ranging automation. It increases the test frequency and enables every developer to check his code changes immediately. VectorCast moves all the sparse controls to the right. So this was my very quick overview about VectorCast. We now learn more about safe embedded compiler solutions in the following presentation by Daniel Kästner. Daniel, I will switch to you.
All right, Vinny, thank you. So welcome to this part of the presentation. I try to share my screen. Okay, so here we go. The question for today is, if you want to run some software on some target, of course you need a compiler. And the question is, well, can you trust your compiler? So before I go into this brief overview of the company, so Absinthe, we are a tool provider, and what we are doing is tools for development of safety and security relevant software. So our focus is really on the validation or certification of safety critical embedded software and security critical software as well. We started off as a spin-off company from the University of Saarbrücken in Germany. We have a bit more than 40 employees, and our customers come essentially from all different countries all over the world, with industries like aerospace, automotive, railway, energy, and also healthcare, medical products. So essentially all industry domains which are somehow related to safety or security related software. Okay, on the next slide we have a couple of our products which are shown as an overview. And for some reason I can't advance my slides. So let's briefly walk through them. The first three tools are in the area of timing analysis. So they're aiming at real-time software. And the first one is called AIT, Worst Case Execution Time Analyzer. This is a static analyzer which works on the binary code. And what it does is to compute upper bounds, guaranteed upper bounds, on the worst case execution time of tasks. So this is on timing predictable processes, and you can be sure that a given task will always finish within the computed time. The timing profiler then is another analysis tool which aims at early development stages. The idea is to develop to compute a quick, fast estimation of the worst case execution time. So for example, if you do model-based software, you click a button, get an estimation of the current worst case execution time, you change the model and see how the worst case execution time changes. So that helps you optimize the worst case timing behavior of the software during development. The Time Weaver then aims at high performance multi-core processors, which are not entirely timing predictable anymore. So here the idea is to perform a hybrid worst case execution time analysis, which means that we extract timing information from non-invasive real-time instruction traces and use this information to compute the worst case path for the application, which gives an upper bound of the worst case execution time. Then the stack analyzer, it's another static analyzer working at the binary code, which computes the maximal stack usage. So here the idea is that you can prove that you will never run into a stack overflow. Well, the topic of today is the COMCERT compiler, which is the only formally verified optimizing C compiler which is on the market today. And we'll hear a lot about this. And then we have also some source level analysis tools, in particular Astree, which finds all possible runtime errors, data races, deadlocks, and other critical coding defects at the source code levels for C++ programs. And well, the root checker, which checks coding guidelines like Mistral, CERT, CWE, and so on. Okay, so let's get back to the question for today. Can you trust your compiler? Well, essentially what a compiler does is just it translates something. So it takes a program in a higher level programming languages and transforms it to the machine code of some target processor. So this doesn't sound very difficult, but actually it's a very hard problem, even in the complexity theory sense. So below the backend in the compiler is a series of NP-complete problems. So in order to solve them efficiently with good results, compilers are running sophisticated algorithms and actually an entire bunch of them. And that means, well, as complex software projects, of course, compilers can contain bugs. So they might crash, they might refuse to compile some code, which is okay. But the worst thing which can happen is that the compiler silently generates wrong code. So the generated machine code just does something different than what has been programmed at the source code level. And it's clear that this is not a good thing. Compiler bugs can cause erroneous behavior, they can cause erratic behavior, so could cause the software to crash or to do something else entirely than it should. And typically, compiler bugs are very difficult to identify. So at the moment, normally, when you get the idea that you might be looking at a compiler bug, you have already spent significant time investigating the issue at hand. So that's one problem. So the second one. So first of all, compiler bugs in the sense of miscompilation can have very bad consequences. They cost you time if you want to hunt them. And the third thing then is that, well, if you have some reasoning about the correctness of the code at higher levels, at the model level, at the source code level, in the moment where the compiler can introduce code generation bugs, well, all of this isn't valid anymore. And if you look at this, so here I have shown a screenshot from the GCC compiler. It's the bug list from the last 7 days. So you can see 198 bugs have been filed. So some of them might be the true bugs, which might be relevant for your code. So if you're developing some safety software, you really would have to closely monitor such things. Okay, well, the concept takes a different angle to this entire approach. So it's what it's about it is that it performs formal, in the sense of mathematically rigorous, proof of the correctness of the compiler. So that means that it's really a formal verification of the compiler itself. And well, the benefit is that, well, if the compilation succeeds, then essentially there is a proof that the generated code behaves exactly as the semantics of the source program indicates it should behave. So that means that there will be no miscompilation here, and we have a proof about that. So that, in a nutshell, means, well, it can provide a level of confidence in the correctness of the compilation process, which just hasn't been possible before. So CompuServe is in use today, so this is an example of a certificate where it has been used in the development process for safety critical nuclear power software. Okay, the terminology is interesting. So I've been talking a lot of formal verification. I think before we dive into this, we should basically set the scene. So one term which is relevant is tool qualification. Well, tool qualification means that if you're using some tool, you have to demonstrate that it does what it should. So it means demonstrating that the functional requirements of the tool are satisfied. And if you look at higher criticality levels, this typically has to be done in the operational context of the tool user, whoever runs the tool on some given machine in some environment, in some development process. In that particular situation, the tool has to work all right. So if you look at ISO 26262, for example, that's called validation of the tool. Well, then another terminology is certification. Certification always means, well, you have some formal attestation or confirmation of certain properties by some accredited body. And then it's you have to look closely what the properties really are. So for example, what you see often for tools is that you have a fit for purpose certificate, which means that in some exemplary development process, it behaves all right. And then we have this formal verification, which means that this is a mathematically rigorous proof of the correctness of something. So that means that you have a very At the product level, a very good evidence that the software performs all right. And actually what you can do is to do to combine all of this, so you can have something which is formally verified, then you can qualify it to show that it really does satisfy the requirements, and with that it's easy to obtain some certification. All right, now let's look at miscompilation. Well, miscompilation happens. So there have been numerous studies in the past, so some of them which are not not in the distant future, are listed on this slide. So for example, in 2007, there was the Nullstone study, and well, they investigated 20 commercially available compilers and found bugs in 12 of them in integer division, which is not one of the most difficult problems there are. Then a bit later, there was another study which investigated, again, production quality compilers. In that case, 13 compilers, and basically found wrong code for each of them when accessing volatile variables. And then another publication, there were, again, looking at lots of different compilers, and essentially all the compilers which have been investigated here were found to have some bugs. So that's a publication from John Reggie and his group. They spent a test case standard generator for testing compilers and found lots of bugs in basically all the compilers investigated. And the interesting thing is that an early development version of the CompCert was also used in this study, and you can read the summary here. So basically, they concluded that the CompCert is the only compiler under test for which there was no miscompilation, no wrong code errors. So they particularly targeted the compiler because that's the first formally verified compiler which is available, but they didn't find errors in the generated code. So that means that, yes, we have some, let's say, theoretical reasoning, a mathematical proof that the compiler works all right, and you can see that this has really tangible benefits. Okay. Well, then let's take a look at the safety standards which are around. So, of course, you don't find the verification obligation that you should have a formally verified compiler because that just wasn't possible. So, let's look at the DO178B or C. So, in general, the approach here is that the compiler should be treated as, oh no, not the compiler, that any kind of code generator should be treated like this. So, either the generator is qualified at the same level of assurance than the application, or you must treat the generated code as being handwritten. So it has to follow the full DO-compliant development process. Well, both is not very realistic for compilers, and then there are the typical compromises you see today. So the first idea is to use compilers which are proven in use, which have been around for some time and where there are chances that people have found all the bugs. Then, of course, you can run a compiler validation suits, which essentially look at the C semantics and try to come up with checks for the language elements. In addition, it could be a good idea to manually review some representative codes. And for high criticality applications, it's also a very good idea to switch off compiler optimizations altogether, which massively reduces the danger, the risk of bugs. Okay, so all these approaches are treated in similar way in other safety norms, like also ISO 26262 or IEC 61508. Okay, and now let's get back to CompCert. So as already explained, it's about having a formal proof, formal verification of the compiler. And what's being verified is actually the semantical preservation for each compiler pass. So each pass of the compiler transforms one intermediate representation into the next. And well, the proof is to show that the outcome of this transformation has the same semantics than the input. Well, all these proofs and transformations have been done with a theorem prover Koch. So that means the proofs are mechanically checked, automatically checked for correctness. And that allows the conclusion: if compilation succeeds, well, then the generated code behaves exactly as expected. So, of course, this is not something we could have started on our own. So basically, the CompCert has been developed as a distributed research project all over the world. since I think briefly after 2000. Key architect was Xavier Leroy, who is now at Collège de France. The source code of the compiler and all the proofs are freely available, so I pasted the link here. And the commercial licenses support maintenance, or if you're interested in new targets, that's available from Absint. And we, of course, we are also contributing to the development. Okay, well, so far we have talked about correctness. Let's also talk about performance. So first, if you look at the code which is generated by Comcert, well, then the first thing to note is that it's about twice as fast as, for example, you take the GCC with no optimizations, -0. But if you look at GCC, which is, let's say, is representative for high performance compilers today, well, and activate the quite ambitious optimization level 3, then the Comcert is just 20% slower. So yes, it's slower, but we are comparing to a high performance compiler here, and we really have the benefit of the proven correctness. The targets which are supported are listed here. So it's PowerPC, 32-bit and 32/64-bit hybrid, ARM, ARM 64-bit, IA32 architecture, IMD 64, and also RISC-V. All right. Regarding the C dialect, well, attempts to prove a compiler correct have been quite numerous over the past decades, and typically they have been conducted on some severely limited language subsets or toy languages. With the Comcert, basically all the C99 semantics is covered, with these exceptions here. So you must not have unstructured switch statements like in DAS device. There's no support for variable length arrays, and if you're using long jump and set jump, well, then you're on your own. This will not be covered by the formal proof. And then in addition, well, Comcert also offers some pragmas and attributes so that you can have some control over low-level properties of the generated code. Okay, so here is the top-level overview. So as you can see here, the core of the Comcert compiler starts from pre-processed C code and extends to the assembly code, so to the generated machine code. It does not include the pre-processing stage, and it also does not include the assembly or linking stage. So if you're switching from some established toolchain to Comcert, you can still continue to use the preprocessor and the assembly linker you used before, and you replace the core of the compiler by the Comcert compiler, where essentially you have a proof of the correctness of the code generation. I'll talk about this a bit later, as an announcement here to provide assurance about the correctness of assembler and linker. Well, this is not part of the core Comcert proof. We have a translation validation tool called Valex, which checks that in the executable you see the same thing as in the assembly code. So here, assembly linkage are outside the proof, but there is some formal reasoning why this should be okay. Okay, now let's look at the core stages of the Comcert. Well, the Comcert consists of a set of compilation passes, so actually 20 of them, which gradually compile the source code into lower and lower intermediate representations until we end up at the machine code. And, well, the four main phases are usual suspects, so it's the parsing stage, of course. So here the preprocessor internal is external. We build the tokens, and then the parser, again, has been formally verified. It's been used, generated by the man here, parser generator along with a cock proof. We have some type checking, some scope resolution. So that's the parsing stage. Then, well, and the proven parts you see in green. Well, and then you can see the front-end compiler itself, so the evaluation order selection, address computations, loop simplifications, and so on. That's all formally proven correct. And the back-end compiler, here you find the usual suspects for compiler optimizations, instruction selection, register allocation, function inlining, sub-expression elimination, and so on. That has all been formally proven correct. Assembling, well, It's done externally, but the COMSA does provide dwarf information, which is also part of the proof, so you can rely on the fact that the dwarf information also is correct. Okay, now let's look at the proof itself. Well, as mentioned, there is a formal reasoning that all passes in the compiler preserve the semantics between input and output. So what's the semantics? Well, the CompSat uses a small step operational semantic specification as a label transition system, and it well, it's a description which covers two aspects. The first aspect is the termination behavior. So either the program terminates normally or abnormally, maybe due to a runtime error, or might run forever. And then we have the trace, which means all observable input-output actions of the program. So system calls, access to volatile variables, and so on. So if you take this together, you have the description what the program is actually doing. Okay, and then, well, the intuitive approach is to say, okay, well, the generated code has to do exactly the same thing as the source code dictates. Well, unfortunately, this is insufficient. That doesn't really work, because there is some non-determinism built in the C language. So, for example, the evaluation order for expressions is not specified. So here, basically, the compilers are free to choose some ordering. There might be other ordering. So, yes, well, the CompSat chooses one ordering. And then there is the interesting aspect of undefined behavior. So the C semantics has some undefined behaviors, which are also listed in the standard, if you look at it, in NXJ. There are most of them. And, well, it's behavior which is not covered by the language semantics. And, well, in that case, if you have such an undefined behavior, well, the behavior of the program is not defined, so the compiler can essentially do what it likes. So this here is an example, a simple example. Let's say we have an array on the stack with two elements, and then we have an assignment T of 2 equals 1. So that's the third element of the array, which just has 2. So we have an out-of-bound array access here, a buffer overflow. Well, and then the program returns 0. Well, buffer overflows are undefined behaviors. So in the C sense, this program has no meaning, or at least this assignment here. Well, and if you execute it, or compile it and execute it on some target, well, then different things might happen. So here, you're actually accessing one stack cell beyond this array T here, which might just be padding bytes, and then, well, it's harmless. The program just normally terminates. Or you might hit the return address of the program, and then, well, when you reach the return statements, it tries to continue at instruction 1, which will not be a very good idea. And if you have a very good compiler, it could even detect that, well, this assignment here is never used, so let's eliminate this assignment. And then again, the program also terminates correctly. So this is not fully covered by the definition. And actually, there have been code attacks based on this. So here, this is a vulnerability from the Linux kernel, which essentially exploits a compiler optimization based on undefined behaviors. So what's happening is that we have a pointer here, and here the pointer is dereferenced. And well, if you have, well, a null pointer dereference is also undefined behavior. So clearly, when you have dereferenced this, and it was a null pointer, well, then the compiler doesn't have to worry about it because it's undefined behavior. And then there is a null check here a bit later on, which determines whether this function here returns error or not. And well, it got optimized away by the compiler because it knew. Well, if you're here, then, well, this can't be null, otherwise we would be undefined, and we can ignore this. So that's kind of an interesting case. Well, all it means is that if you want to have some meaningful semantic preservation specification, then you must be able to account for this. So the precise formulation is shown here. So semantic preservation means that, well, all observable behaviors have to be the same, or they have to, let's say, improve over the allowed behavior by replacing undefined behaviors by more defined behavior. So we have to mathematically formulate this, and then you can run the proofs. Well, technically, the proofs are conducted with simulation diagrams that relate essentially the transition in C to the transition of the different intermediate representations. There are 15 different simulation diagrams which are proven independently, and then there is a proof about their composition that all of them together are working all right. Okay, a little sidetrack about undefined behaviors. So we have seen that there can be undefined behaviors in the program. And if you look at the C norm, you will find the list of the undefined, unspecified behaviors there are. And well, some of them can really cause severe defects. And well, there are tools which are able to detect this. And if you have some formal version of static analysis based on abstract interpretation, then you can prove that such defects are not in the code. One tool for this, for example, is the AS3 analyzer. And it specifically aims at proving the absence of such unspecified or undefined behaviors in C or C++, which includes array index, out of bounds, excesses, division by zero, buffer overflows, uninitialized variables, and also data races, deadlocks, and so on. So it can do a lot more, like data and control flow analysis, cybersecurity-oriented analysis, also check coding guidelines. But the important thing is that, well, you can run proofs that the program will be free of undefined behaviors. Okay, so I've mentioned the translation validation. So at the end of the proven stage of COMCERT, we have the machine code. And then there is some external assembler and linker, which produces the final binary code. And well, then the idea of translation validation is, well, to take the generated machine code, so it's represented in JSON format here, and to take the generated executable code, and then just to check that they contain the same things. So this is a lot easier than to prove that the transformation ending up there is correct. You just take the input, take the output, and show that they are the same. So that's what the VALEX tool is doing. And what it checks, well, first the executable is disassembled, and then VALEX checks that every function you have in the in the assembly code can be found in the executable, that the machine instructions which are generated match for all variables which are in the machine level program. You have to find its symbol in the symbol table of the executable. Size and initialization information must match. Well, for all symbolic names or labels, there must be unique address. Variables and functions must be placed in the right sections. So there is a set of criteria, and if you can match them, then you have well, quite a good confidence that both are equivalent. Okay, so coming back to the aspects which are not formally proven, so I just talked about the sampling and linking, where we have this translation validation. What about the preprocessor? Well, the preprocessor is essentially easy, so you could check this manually, or you could just run two different preprocessors and compare the output, so that's not really a big challenge. If you look at the front-end parsers, well, the core thing, the parser, has been formally proven correct, but there are some aspects which have not been proven, like if you want to put struct arguments on the stack, but this is very limited scenarios. You might even deactivate, and they're quite easy to test. So there's no big complexity here. And then we have the C library, which is an interesting thing. Well, the question is whether the C library behaves as it should. Well, this is also outside the compiler proof. But there are, here in this case, there are approaches to qualify libraries. Well, so there are companies like Validus who are doing this. And you can also cover it in validation suites. Well, and the COMCERT also has a validation suite, so which means it has a formal correctness proof about what the COMCERT is doing, but we are also offering a qualification kit so you can validate it. And of course, these things here are quite simple, so you have good chance that you can cover them very well with a qualification kit, with a validation suite, which is not the case if you have highly complex transformations inside the compiler, because that's not what validation suites try to do. Okay, to summarize the confidence argument. So the core thing, where really the typical compiler bugs come from, is the code generation compiler passes, and they have been formally proven free of miscompilation errors. And in particular, this includes all the compiler optimizations. The aspects not covered by the proof, now I've mentioned most of them. Some of it which I did not mention yet is, well, the correctness of the specification. So right at the beginning, of course, you have to have a formal semantics of C. And in that case, well, there is a reference interpreter which has been proven correct in Cox. So, well, you can also test that the C semantics Comstat assumes is really correct. So that's one aspect. Then we have talked about some unproven elements of the parsing phase. Well, they can be well covered by the validation suite. We have Alex, which can cover sampling and linking. So all this you can find in the Comstat validation suite. And that means, well, if you take it all together, it means it's a very big leap between what's possible with, let's say, traditional compilers and their qualification kits to what's possible with Comstat. Okay, so I mentioned the execution time of the generated code. So this here is on the spec marks, some breakdown. So blue means GCC minus O0, green is Comstat. So you can see that, this is quite a lot faster. GCC minus O1 minus O2 is also listed. In orange, we have O2. So you can see that, well, more or less on average, the Comstat is comparable to GCC minus O2. So this was about performance, code size. It looks a bit similar. The Comstat again is in green, and if you take the GCC and specifically do size optimizations, then the generated code is smaller. If you take the other compilation optimization levels, then you will see that, well, the Comstat tends to be smaller. Okay. Another aspect which is interesting is to look at the test effort. So if it's possible to have, let's say, a proven correctness of the compiler, well, it would be an interesting thing to leverage this to try to reduce the test effort, or let's say to shift it to host-based tests. And what's very interesting is if you have the Comstat to compile on host and on target, you have essentially the reasoning that on the host and on the target, you do not have miscompilation. And then when you additionally make sure that you try to be independent of implementation defined behaviors and let's say processor specific behaviors such as endianness and of course undefined behaviors, then you can be pretty sure that, well, actually you will see the same thing on the host and on the target. And, well, coding guidelines, if you look, for example, at MISRA, the MISRA coding guidelines, and sometimes also architectural constraints, so both of which are listed, for example, in ISO 26262, they're explicitly focusing on this. So if you can be very clean here, then you essentially have a proven chain. So that means that, and even if there are some aspects which are not fully excluded, it still means that you don't have to worry about, let's say, compiler correctness and think that maybe by your testing you can also implicitly test the compiler. You really can focus on the specification risk, on the functional properties, what the testing is all about. You get the test coverage, the structural coverage on the application code under test, of course, not on the implementation of the compiler. So that means you can use the testing for what it should do. And that also means if you already can analyze the host software, well, it means that you can start verifying your software properties earlier. And then you have some argument that these correctness properties will translate to the later phases. Okay, so this would be, let's say, the big picture of code level verification. So you can do some things at the source code, like you can do fancy formal verification using model checkers or theorem proving on the source code. Well, and then at first this doesn't have a link to the executable code, well, because the executable code might do something different. Then you can run static analysis on the code, so you could prove that there are no runtime errors, no data races, which is always fine because that works at the C code level. You can also try to prove functional properties with abstract interpretation-based static analysis. Then, the question would be how this relates to the executable code. Then, of course, you can check for coding guidelines. At the executable code, you would look for things like stack usage versus execution time, and you can, of course, do the target host-based testing. And now if you have a formally verified compiler, then you have a nice chain, and suddenly your correctness arguments, the test effort, the verification effort you did at higher stages will translate you to the executable, and you have good confidence argument for it. Well, as mentioned, this has been used in certification projects like for nuclear emergency power generators, for nuclear power plants, which already brings me to my conclusion slide. So to sum it up, well, the COMCERT is kind of a novel concept. It really does something which has not been possible before, to have an optimizing compiler on a realistic, on a full programming language on C, with a formal correctness proof that the compiler will not generate wrong code, will not miscompile. Well, of course, this is great because it reduces the risk of failures in the field. You can be sure by the formal verification of the compiler that there will be no miscompilation. You will have the intended behavior, and that means that, well, taken all together, the confidence in the correctness of the compiler is a lot higher than with what has been possible before. You can also leverage the formal correctness argument to reduce test effort and also to validate the source code verification activities, because then you suddenly have some formal reasoning why the soft safety properties you have established at the source code should carry over to the executable code as well. And what's also very important is, well, the performance of the generated code is comparable to state-of-the-art modern high-performance compilers, not if you let them run with the highest performance optimization level, but which again would have the highest danger of running into compiler bugs. And even compared to this setting, it's just 20% slower. All right, so that concludes my presentation, and then I think I will hand over to Ingo.
Yes, thank you, Daniel. Yeah, excuse me if I don't share my video, because I was disconnected from this webinar twice already for about 20 seconds. Because of bandwidth issues, I will try to avoid data transmission as far as possible. So bandwidth shouldn't be a problem. We have a pretty quick internet, so I wonder if it's a problem with the webinar software. Maybe it is not so well tested, but about testing, I want to say something about VectorCast. If you are using, or if you have the idea, or if you are interested in using a formally verified compiler, then it's you are obviously interested in a good quality of your product, or you're even in a safety critical software development or product development in general. And then what you should do, or what you can do, is you can unit test your software, which is part of the recommended process to assure high quality software. Now, for unit testing, it's important from our point of view to use the product compiler, not to test the software somewhere on a different chip with a different compiler, but do run the tests in the end, at least with a real compiler on the real chip with a real thing. So for this webinar, what I prepared is I made VectorCast run and unit test using the COMCERT compiler from Absint. And so that you understand how that works, I prepared one picture that I am now sharing. And the way VectorCast works is, if you want to unit test your source code, then you pick one file, one C file, one class that you want to test. The first thing we do is we do pre-process code. That means we ask the compiler to preprocess, which means it expands header files, it expands macros. Then the result of the preprocessing is passed by VectorCast. We fully understand the code on the test, including the expanded macros and header files. And then we build the test harness. What is the test harness? The test harness is source code that can be generated, that can be compiled and linked to build a unit test application. And the file under test and the functions under test, the classes under test, are part of this test harness, are part of this unit test application. There is a test driver. The test driver has the main, and the test driver has calls to the functions on the test. And also in unit testing, very common is that you want to work with stubs or with mocks. With VectorCast, we call them stubs. And they are created automatically. External dependencies, functions that are called by the code under test, but are not part of the code under test, are automatically stubbed. VectorCast creates source code, CFIT and header files for the test harness, and then we use your toolchain, we use your compiler, we use your linker to build a binary, to build the unit test application. And to be precise, we build two versions of the unit test executable. One, unit test is not instrumented to verify that the not instrumented version of the code gives the proper results. And we also have a instrumented version having source code instruction points so that we know lines were executed or not executed. And you can rerun the same test cases on the same source code, but with the instrumented version. And then you get code coverage, whatever coverage level you desire. This binary can be copied, flashed, transferred somewhere, somehow to your embedded target and executed there. Now, at the moment, there is no test case data yet. The test driver calls the functions under test using global variables. The question is, what test data is put to the global variables? What do we expect as return values? Now, this information, input values and expected values, is separated from the unit test executable. It's stored in ASCII files. And these are somehow read, well, more or less on execution time of a test case, read or part of the unit test binary that is then executed on the embedded device. Now, for this demo that I'm now showing, I used CompSat and I used QEMU, Quick Emulator. And you may wonder, why are there gray boxes and why are there red boxes? And the answer is the red parts are VectorCast parts. We do parse the code, the preprocessed code, and we do build the test harness. But other than that, we call your compiler to preprocess, we call your compiler to compile, we call your linker to link. And the execution will be done on Quick Emulator in this case, which could, of course, also be a real chip. We call the CompSert toolchain. I know that the CompSert probably does not itself preprocess and maybe not itself link. Maybe it does use GCC linker or GCC standard like preprocessing. But we don't care. We call CompSert and whatever it does underneath when being used in your real build process will also be used to build the unit test binary so that the code under test is generated identically with the VectorCast or as part of the unit test environment as it will be in the final product. Long story, now the tool in action. We want to create a new unit test environment, and this is done in 5 minutes. So before the Q&A session, let's create a unit test environment. What I did for this webinar is I started with a GCC ARM compiler, bareboard ARM Cortex-A7, and this does not mean that we ship VectorCast with all these compilers. Those are prepared templates that you can use to configure the setup in VectorCast. So if you're using any of these embedded compilers on the left, then you want to use VectorCast to unit test, then you would select one of those templates that match best your local settings. And then you will have a pre-filled preprocessor commands, compiler commands, linker commands, and you can adapt them so that they match your configuration. Now, in my case, I don't want to use the ARM on ARB. I want to use the CCOM, the CompSat compiler from Upstint. And I did that. I prepared that, and I also added the Upstint CompSat compiler configuration to my list of templates. And then I did use Quick Emulator to execute. So what we see now is, what we will see is we see the preprocessor command, which is comcert or ccomp, also for compiling, also for linking, we use ccomp. And then for the execution, I use the standard execution method that is shipped more or less with the template configuration for the GDR. There is a Python script that is used to execute. This Python script also starts the quick emulator, which is a nice thing. It then starts the GDB debugger and connects the debugger to the quick emulator. It also sets some breakpoints, so that's very nice. The unit test environment needs a name, and this can be anything. Then we can select some code coverage, and this is already pre-selected. We have statement and MCDC coverage. We need to select a file that we want to unit test, which can be any on the list of files that we found in the include paths that are pre-configured. And now when we build, we do the steps that I showed in the picture. We do call ccomp to preprocess. We do parse the preprocessed code. We do build the test harness source files. Then we call ccomp to compile all the test harness files. We call ccomp to link. And then we already executed the binary, the bcastl file, on the target, which is in this case the quick emulator. And we do this to determine, to find the ranges for the used types, for an integer, for a short. We want to know what are minimum values, what are maximum values on the embedded device where we want to run test cases. And that's why we already execute the unit test executable when just building the test environment. Now, the executables are there. The instrumented version is built. And if I want to create a test case, I can just right-click one function. I can enter data input values and expected values, for example, for the parameters. I can decide how do I want to call the function under test. As you can see, the test case editor knows the underlying types of the parameters. We know or we can expect return values. We could access global variables, set any input values, or predefine global variables before we call the function under test, and also check expected values. Maybe we want globals to change, maybe we don't want them to change. We can also access stubs. We can set stubs to check parameters that are passed to the stubs, and we can also tell the stubs to return values. For example, for this test case, we can tell the stub to return different values than for another test case. So like this, once we have set our input and expected values, we can execute the test case. And this really runs the Python script that I just showed, as we can see here. Whereas we first do indeed compile. Why do we compile? Because we store the test case data, in this case, into C globals, global consts. And these consts are compiled and then linked to the unit test executable. That's why we see one call to ccomp for compiling the test case data and one call to ccomp for linking. And then we see the execution of the test case by running the Python script, which, as I said, runs quick emulator. We can look at code coverage. We see which lines in the code were executed. So this is what you get from what you would expect from a unit test tool. The last thing I want to show is that we can also use this tool chain or this setup to debug the code under test just by right-clicking and doing the execute with debug. I prefer to do this without coverage. That means we do execute the unit test executable that is not instrumented, and because then we don't have the instrumentation points to measure the code coverage. That means, of course, we need to build the uninstrumented version first. So here, this is our debugger window. Vectorcast is waiting for the return from the debugging. That's why it still counts and it waits, and it marked that job as being yellow because nothing happens, but it will wait forever. So we have time. We see that we started in main, so we are in the test driver of the unit test executable, and now we can do our usual debugging things however we like. Also, we see that the Python script was so kind to already set a breakpoint in the function under test, so we can just continue, and we are in the function under test, and we can continue here to see what's going on, what's happening. We can also look at the backtrace, for example, to see how did we come here, and then we see we started in main. We came from the test driver for module number 9, and then now we are in function place order. So this is pretty much what I wanted to show. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them. And now I will go give back to Winnie. Winnie, what do you have for us?
Yes, thank you, Ingo. Second. So, we will now come to the Q&A part of today's webinar. As said in the beginning, send us your questions via the Q&A window. Daniel, I see that there are already some questions to you. Can you please read and answer them?
Yes, actually, there have been quite some questions, so thank you for that. I'm just browsing through them. Yes, well, one question is about the preprocessor, because I mentioned in the slide part that the CompSat was not doing the preprocessing, and in Ingo's demo, you could see, you had the CCOM command doing the preprocessing. So actually, this is just a script which then called the existing compiler, in that case, the GCC ARM compiler, to do the preprocessing. But you can easily put a script around this. We can also have some pre-configured scripts so that it doesn't feel a lot different than calling another compiler. So just the fact that you are calling into the external preprocessors, that doesn't hinder you in the development process. Okay, that's one question. Ah, yes, a very important question, whether the presentations will be made available. So yes, we can send them to you, of course. Just let us know. Then, well, there is a question whether the Infineon Tri-Core family is supported by the CompSat. Not yet, but basically we also develop support for new targets on order, so this is certainly possible. It's the same kind of architectures we are supporting at the moment, so that's definitely doable. Right. Okay. Yes, well, then there was a question, how much is it is possible to reduce the development effort using CompSat? Of course, that's a quite difficult question, which depends on the development process and the entire, let's say, chain of tools and measures which are taken in the software. So this is very extremely hard to answer. But actually, there is a publication we could send you that was a joint publication with MTU, where they describe the use of CompSat in their development process and also the benefits they had from it. So if you send me a note, I can make this paper available to you. Right. Well, then there is another question about qualification according to ISO 26262 about proven in use arguments for compilers. Well, I'm not so sure about compiler qualification in ISO 26262. I would recommend, let's say, the CompSat way that you can say, okay, you have a formally verified compiler, you have a decent qualification based on solid ground, so you can have, let's say, the normal clauses for validation of the tool, which applies to ASL C or D, and just running the validation suite is also It doesn't take a big effort, so you can easily do the same to do the qualification for lower ASLs, of course, because it doesn't involve a lot of effort in doing this. Right, I think, the next question is, CompCert a C only or a C++ compiler? Well, the question, the answer here is clearly it's C, because with C++ we would be lacking the first step, which means the description, the formal description of the language semantics. As soon as that's available, I don't know anybody who has suggested one, we could start thinking about it, but since already the formal semantics is missing, it's a tough question. Well, it's not a tough question, it's a good question, but a tough thing to do. All right, I think if I didn't miss any, that have been the questions.
Okay, thank you, Daniel. Ingo, do you got any questions to answer?
There is indeed, or there are some interesting questions. For example, there is, the short questions first, is QEMU shipped with VectorCast? No, we don't deliver the quick emulator with VectorCast, but it can be downloaded from somewhere. Does VectorCast support DAWs? And does VectorCast support Polarion? There is a requirements gateway, so we can import requirements into the unit test tool and link test cases to requirements. So that you get a functional test case, including traceability from test case to requirement. And there are different, adapters, different Python scripts available to connect to different requirements gateway, requirements management systems. Then there is a question, there is a concrete question regarding VectorCast compared to a different unit test tool. I will not say the name of that test tool, but in general, is VectorCast better or not? Well, that's a difficult question. I would certainly say VectorCast is better than any other unit test tool out there, but probably every test tool vendor would say the same thing. So I would think that if you were interested in looking at a different test tool, then it would be best to just ask for a demo. We can have a two-hour online meeting and then maybe discuss differences. Maybe it's a good thing to think about what are the things that you don't like about your current solution, about your existing test tool. Why would you want to look into other test tools if you were happy? And then maybe look how those things are solved with VectorCast. There is a question regarding the support for Cortex-R family. I guess that's probably a question for you, Daniel.
It's answered already.
Did you answer?
Yeah, yes.
Was up. I'm sorry. Okay.
Yes, I saw it too. Well, so the ARM instructions that is supported, so I would say the answer to that would be yes. And I see that there are some more questions which have come in. So there's a question from Dave. Does the CompCert compiler identify all undefined behaviors? That's a very good question, and no, it doesn't. So therefore, I mentioned the ASTRE tool. So ASTRE is a static analyzer which you can use to identify certain kinds of undefined behaviors, those related to critical defects typically. And then you could activate coding guidelines, like for example MISRA, and then try to nail down all the undefined behaviors in the software. But this has to be done externally to the CompCert compiler.
Any more questions? So I see nothing on my list.
Oh yes, one more, proving the formal correctness of atomic operations, like sync fetch. So sounds like built-in operations. So to check whether the implementation of such operations is correct, I think this would be outside of CompCert. But you can incorporate them. Let's say if you have some reasoning why the implementation of the sync fetch is correct, then you could try to specify the behavior of such kind of intrinsics formally, and then the COMSAT can integrate this into the formal proofs. So in a similar way, we have also built-ins, let's say intrinsics for the COMSAT compiler, which have a formal semantic specification and can be carried through the formal proof.
Okay, we are a little bit over time. I would say we have to come to the end now. I thank you, Daniel and Ingo, for your presentation. We all thank all participants for your interest, and we hope that you enjoy this webinar. If you are interested in getting more information about the Vector events, please visit vector.com or register for our monthly newsletter. Last but not least, please visit our blog about software quality at coderskitchen.com. That's all for today. Please stay healthy. Thank you very much. Goodbye and auf Wiedersehen.
Thank you. Take care. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.